I would just simply define it as using digital sources for historical purposes, and that would simply be digitizing existing documents or creating new things by the use of digital technology, but all for the purposes of doing history. I would use it in a very traditional way. That is, I use my own work tends to use documents that are digitized. I don't myself digitize anything. I use other people's things. And so I don't really, I'm not like some of the other people who are here for the symposium and using digitization to create new things. I'm just making use of digital tools as a method of historical research. There are certain things that it makes very much easier. For example, one of the things I have started to, students have started to use, and they're using it, they've told me with great success, is the new Redex digital archive of early American newspapers. These are newspapers that previously have been accessible to us only on microcard, then microfiche, and some microfilm, which are very difficult to read. And the Redex Corporation, in conjunction with the American Antiquarian Society, is in the process. It is by no means complete. They're in the process of digitizing all the extant copies of early American newspapers. They are not doing it with the world's greatest images. That is, they are digitizing the microfilm images. But even so, you can read it more easily on your home computer or on your computer in your office or in the library more easily than you can on the microfilm. It's a lot easier, and furthermore, it is keyword searchable. And that's the crucial thing, because if you're looking for something in an early American newspaper, in the past it's meant cranking the microfilm reel for long periods of time, but now you can do a keyword search. On the other hand, I have to say that before the Cornell Library decided to sign up and spend the amount of money, it's quite expensive to use this database, they asked me to be one of the testers for it. They got a free use subscription to it, and I discovered a number of mistakes and errors in the way that the material had been digitized and had been, and the way in which the keywords turned up. It just so happened that I had had a research assistant read through some of the newspapers on microfilm already and get some of the things I was interested in out of it. And so I tested the keyword searching against what my research assistant had already found. And in some cases, it just simply didn't turn up things that were very important that my research assistant had found by scrolling through the microfilms. And so that does concern me, that it has to be done properly. That is, the indexing and the keyword searching has to be done properly. Otherwise, things will be missed. On the other hand, boy, it makes it a lot easier. Well, my own research, I think, the first time I did it, I did anything on digital, of a digital nature, is the website of the Salem Witch Trials website, which is out of the University of Virginia. While I was in the middle of writing my book, In the Devil's Snare, I had finished researching it, but while I was in the middle of writing it, Ben Ray of the University of Virginia put up on the web all the original images of the documents. And this turned out to be incredibly important for me. I had actually purchased 3 reels of microfilm from the Phillips Library, which holds most of the materials, and also had purchased Xerox copies of some of the documents from the Massachusetts Historical Society. But there are documents in other places, and they were all on the web. And so while I was writing the book, and I was in England writing the book, first I was in England and then I was at the Huntington Library, and I was able, because the transcriptions are less than perfect, the transcriptions are also on the website, but the transcriptions which were published in 1977 is what I had done my research on. What it meant was that once I wanted to quote a document, I could call up the original document, the image of the original document on the web, and look at it and make sure that the transcription of the quotation I wanted to use was correct. Or in one case where when I looked at the transcription, I realized it made no sense. And I went on the web and I discovered that the transcriber is interesting, because when I had been transcribing it myself, taking notes on it, I hadn't realized that it made no sense. But when I read it for using in my book, I realized that it made no sense, and I went to the web and I discovered that the transcriber in the 1930s, because what was published in 1977 were transcriptions done in the 1930s by the WPA, I discovered that the transcriber in the 1930s had skipped 3 lines. And so had gone from, you know, the way one's once I does jump from one point to another point, if it's the word, same word, that the person, the typist in the 30s had skipped three lines, it really changed the meaning of what was going on in the document. So the web was very helpful to me in that regard, this website. And that's what I've done myself mostly, and that I also use in teaching now. And then this, the Redex, but that's about all I've done. I do think that it can reach, that one of the things that it does, and certainly has done for me in my teaching, is it enables me to show my students this semester the uses of the particular original images of the Salem witchcraft documents, which is very important for them, because it's not just making sure that it's correct language, but one of the things about the Salem documents that you can tell from the images that you can't tell from the transcriptions is the different handwriting, and also that some words have been squeezed in, and it's just like looking at the original document, obviously, because you're looking at the image of the original document, and you can really tell things from looking at the original document that you cannot tell from the transcription, as to, you know, there are notations by court clerks. Sometimes there's three or four different layers of notation. There are dockets on the back of the document which were not always transcribed and which sometimes tell you a lot about the document itself. So what I can do with my students, therefore, is give them a much better historical grounding in the documentary sources that we're using in class, because we have the images of the original documents. And this is true, of course, in other types of websites, too. I've never used other websites in teaching, but I do know about a number of other really good historical websites. And I think that if people find them, they will certainly get a better introduction to early American history than they could otherwise, because the documents of early American history, my own field, are rare enough and are concentrated enough in only certain libraries that what the web is making possible is to bring the actual materials out there for people in a way that's not just never been possible before.